School of Art team. Where the light is, right? Oh, good, that's, oh, is that too dark? Is that better? You'd rather it like this? Darker, a little. Oh, you like it like this? Okay, vote. How many people like it like this? One. Okay. Okay. Great. Today we have a complex thing to think about. I mean, not like we haven't had a complex thing to think about before. Now we have a double one. This is on secrets. I want to ask you about secrets. So before we really get into the secrets, two things. The first thing is, do you remember the main method that we're using at the moment? Starts with a T. Talos, good. And it's said with a proper gravity. Talos. Richard James, excellent. Okay, so Talos. And what does that mean?
Purpose.
No, no.
I don't know.
Yes.
Purpose. Something about a beginning.
Yes.
Process and an end.
Right. And what about those beginning processes and ends?
So that's the word.
Okay.
Then they're all the same thing.
Kind of. Yeah. Kind of all the same thing. But it depends where you begin. In it. Right. So the thing about the telos that you have to remember is that the goal, where you're going, is really secretly the reason for you beginning. So the goal gives you a purpose for how and when and where and why you have begun the way you've begun. So let's take a short goal, your MA. That's your goal. But to get to your goal, you know that you've had to come to the Birmingham School of Art. And you've begun your course starting by coming, for example, to this absolute spot here. So this is the beginning, and then we trudge through toward your goal. So we try and make it to the goal, trudge, trudge, trudge. And in making it to the goal, hello. Now, we just started, David, just so you
Thank
know.
Thank you very
just
much.
Started.
I appreciate that.
In making it to the goal, do you have a place to sit?
I'm going
Here's
to
a chair here.
Oh, is there
actually? So, in making it to the goal, you are on a path. How wide is your path? You're on a path. Are you on a precipice? What's your path look like, literally?
It's on the ground.
Okay, let's say it's on the ground.
No, I mean, you have ground.
You have ground, yes. You have ground, and it is, let's say, literally the ground. Is your path tarred? Is it gravel? Is it concrete? What's your path look like? Does it have weeds growing in it? What's your path?
Forest.
It's a forest, nice. Does it have smells, nice smells to it?
Oof.
Pine smells. Mm-hmm. I used to, as I've mentioned probably before, maybe I haven't mentioned it, I used to have a horse named Manhattan, which was Ojibwe for where the two rivers meet, split face, with the paint. It was a beautiful, wild, wild, wild maniac of a horse. And I was taught how to ride, not properly, by having a piece of paper between my bottom and the top of the horse's back. And when the paper didn't fly out, that's when you could ride. That's how we were taught. And it was pretty much like that. And Manhattan was a very wild beast, and he was given to me as a present because they were going to kill him. And they said, well, you seem good with animals. Do you want them? I was like, great. I have a lunatic horse to deal with. Okay, so that just seemed like fun. Anyway, we had a great time, Manhattan and I. And he used to take off in the forest, in these pine forests, 6,000 hectares in one direction, you know, and would go in and out of the trees like a maniac, because he was a maniac, and I loved that. He loved it. We both loved it. And one day there was an eagle, and it was a female eagle. I know this because we were too close to the nest. I mean, the nest was in the trees, so we weren't that close, but we were close enough. And she came swooping down. And at that time, originally I used to ride with a cowboy hat. I had to look myself. But then, because he was such a wild horse, I thought, no, I really need a helmet. So I couldn't bear the kind of horse helmets that they have in English riding. So I had a bike helmet with like slats in it. And the eagle came down with its talons and grabbed the helmet and tried to fly off. And I thought to myself, you know, you can just see the wings and this kind of thing. I thought to myself, you know, if this works, you're going to eat for years. You know, you've got the rider, you've got the horse, you know, like we're all going together. You know, it's like, so I tell you that story because the path had a lot of stuff on it, a lot of adventures on this path. That type of path has lots of adventures. What does your path look like?
You know, those sludgy things that you've got to wade through.
Mm-hmm. That's fun. Yeah. Mud.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sinking at the moment.
Sinking. Mm, good. Anybody else have a path you want to talk about?
Deciduous woodland. Very dappled light. Nice stream. Really quite curvy path. Path going off there. Path going off there. Oh, that one looks nice. Oh, that looks nice.
So light, the smells.
Yeah.
So
a dog as well.
A dog is on your path. Yeah. Okay. You get the fact that a path doesn't have to be a nothing. A path can have dreams on it. A path can have smells on it. It can have mud on it. It's a path. It's leading somewhere. When you have a goal, the path is leading to a goal. Right? Like in the eagle's case, it was leading to her nest. It didn't quite work out for her. But this path and the goal comes back around to give you the push forward. And that is the basis of 2,000 years of metaphysics. You can get this, you've cracked a lot. Okay? So just keep remembering, that path can be like the beautiful forest, the dappled, deciduous moment, the mud. It can be like all that. You can be sinking in it. So a path isn't just a surface. Path isn't just a line. However, no matter how many things are on this path, including Little Red Riding Hood, and you know what happened to poor Red Riding Hood? What happened with Red? She went off the path.
She went off the path.
Yeah.
She got eaten.
And, you know, not only that, it gives you an idea. So if you decide to go off the path, for whatever reasons, the moral to those stories tend to be bad things will happen to you. You go off the path. Of course, if you have a chance to look at the film called In the Company of Wolves, which was done by Angela... I can't even realize her name.
Carter.
Yeah, Angela Carter. Thank you. It's all about Riding Hood, Red Riding. Red goes off the path and hangs out with the wolves. So it's fantastic. It's totally different. You know, it's like, yeah, I love Big Fire. Anyway, I tell it to you like this. So you're not going to think that the path, when I tell you the next sentence, you're not going to think incorrectly what I'm going to tell you. That path, dappled, muddy, sinking, eagles, smells, is linear. It doesn't matter if the path curves. It doesn't matter if you can sink. It's linear. It's a linear logic. Why is it linear? This is what you must understand. Why is that path linear, even though it can go off in many different directions, you can get sidetracked, as it were? Why would that be considered linear?
Because of the progression.
Very good. And what are you progressing toward?
Your goal.
Your goal. And the goal does what?
Pushing you forward.
Pushing you forward, because the goal actually comes back around and goes, bush, like this. So if I say non-linear logic, that doesn't mean that there's no such thing as a path. That simply means that the goal isn't the object of the path. So write that down just like that. The goal is not the object of the path.
That's non-linear.
That's non-linear. When the goal, at the moment we're putting it in negatives, when the goal is not the object of the path, in fact, let's say there isn't even a goal, so it's irrelevant whether or not it's the object, there's no goal whatsoever, you're playing in the dangerous area called non-linear logic. Now we're going to let that sit for a little bit. Because we're going to go back to linear logic and all the various things you can do with it. You can be Little Red Riding Hood and meet various creatures along the way. You can be on your horse like I was with Manhattan. You can do lots of things with telos.
Sorry.
It's okay. So the telos implies linear, but it's not linear in the sense that everything's stuck together and continuous in a way that you can't break through it. Because you could make steps, you could jump to the next part. You could have different ways of intersecting that path. But you're on the path and it has a goal. Okay? You're willing to accept that? Okay, good. Yeah? Okay, good. Now, so that's the first thing about telos. Telos has to do with the goal, the start, and the process. But remember that these all have not layers, but they have like thicknesses. They can be thick. They can be thin. And they can be without any kind of surface. They can be just your imagination. They mean lots of things. The path is a very peculiar thing. And this is why the telos is so complex and at the same time so simple. And most fabulous ideas are both very simple and very complex. And that's when you go, wow, that's fabulous. It's really interesting. Okay, so we're there? Okay. Next thing to remember. That's the first thing. The next thing to remember. Remember that someone really wants you. you know, do you remember the question about 665? What is that? What is 665?
The
least of all possible evils. So let's say that you are laboring under the least of all possible evils. So you're in a terrible relationship, but you figure, well, it could always be worse. Okay, so I'm going to stay in this bad relationship because God knows it could be worse. Something like that. You're laboring in that thing. The goal, the telos, is still involved. This is what I want you to get a sense of. To think through, how is this telos involved in something like 665? In something that is not quite the goal. Let's say the goal is to live happily ever after, have that life come back on you and push you forward. But in fact, you're living not happily ever after. You're living a stalemate, crummy relationship in a rundown place with 5 million children, and you don't know what to do with them all. And you're losing your mind, okay? That's still going to come back and push you forward. So you're still on a path.
So sorry I'm late.
That's all right.
The tutorial overran slightly.
That's right.
Thank you.
You'll be asked many questions. First, what is the path?
That was my little joke.
Okay. Are we focusing? So the first example of the path, you had a goal, nobody was playing around with a goal. Nobody was questioning whether or not it was a full goal, a half full goal, an almost full goal, a just beginning goal, a goal that really is totally impractical goal. Nobody's questioning that. There's just a goal, and it comes back around, and pushes you forward. But what if the goal is the least of all possible evils? So it's not a full goal. It's only a half full goal, or it's a 665 goal as opposed to a 666 goal. Do you understand what I'm saying? I don't want to lose anybody in this move. So you have a 100% goal, which is MA. It's not sort of an MA, or we'll get an MA if everything works out. That's your goal. Your goal is get the MA. And then you work toward it and deal with all the garbage that comes your way dealing with this insanity called the MA. But what happens if the goal is a goal that's based on not fully having a full goal, having a sort of goal, like the least of all? Are you comfortable?
Yeah.
Are you comfortable? You have a little squish there. Because there's a chair with things on it that you could sit on.
Right. Okay.
Just saying.
So these are short legs.
You look like you're all right. I am listening. All fine. Everything's good. Okay. Let's try again. So the goal, think about it when the goal is not quite finished as a goal. It's a half finished or, yeah? Did you have a question? No. It's half, okay. We move to Abraham and his half finished goal, which is the dealing with the son question. Oh, by the way, I went to see Orestier. Is anybody, am I saying that right?
Orestier.
Yes, yes, no one knows what I'm saying.
I
like,
this song.
You did.
No, I
did. Now you understand because I have my translator here. Okay. What is that?
Orestier.
Yeah. Orestier.
Orestier.
Oh, whatever. Anyway. That's yeah, sorry. You're correct. I'm bad. Okay, I went to see the play, which is phenomenal, and if you can get someone to buy you tickets, this is the key, you have to see this play. This was written by, Aeschylus, yes. Yes, thank you. How's that?
Aeschylus.
Is that right? A-U-S-C-E something other. Yes.
Well, I don't know.
Anyway, thank you. So it's very frightening what Mattia knows. Okay. never play, you know, Scrabble. That he'll pull out, you know. Okay. At that time period, there was a whole argument going on about whether or not you paid with a child if something needed to be done, like a war needed to be won. Like there would be signs, and would the signs be such that if you could pay with a child, usually a girl child who is a virgin, etc., then the war would be won. This kind of thing. This was very much a part of the literature, and I was. What's interesting about this play is that they remake it into contemporary time, and so the moral questions are all very complicated because it's always about the price of the child and how much will the parent. So the father, Agamemnon, is told by the gods that you must give your daughter as a price to win this war. And he says, I am not giving, I know, what father would ever do this? It's ridiculous, I would never do this, and so on and so forth. But then he gets talked into it because everybody has, they keep saying, well, look, there's all these signs on, you know, look, it says, you know, if you read these tea leaves this way, it clearly says that your daughter, you know, will have to be murdered, and you know you have to give. And so then, his wife,
Clytemnestra.
Thank you. She gets very annoyed, and she says, you know, how can you do this? How can you ruin the family? This is incredible. And he says, I must do this. I must kill our youngest child. And so he does kill the child. And they have a huge battle, and they, you know, the husband and the wife fall out, and then eventually the winds come, and 12 years later the war is won. Okay, so it's not won immediately, so there's a little bit of a delay in winning the war, but eventually they win. So the wife who is being portrayed like, has anybody seen the thing called House of Cards? Okay, so the woman who played Robin Wright, who plays the wife in House of Cards. So that's how they've cast Clytemnestra.
Thank
you. Just point to you.
I think that they didn't sacrifice her at the end.
No, they did. In this play, in this version.
Ah,
okay.
I mean in mythology, in the reality.
No, they did. They did, in reality. And so, because what happens is they have sacrificed the child. So then the mother, after the war is won, the father comes home as a hero, and the mother then kills the father in revenge for having killed the daughter. And then the son kills the mother because he loved his father. And even though the son lost a sister, it was more serious for him that he lost his father. So he kills the mother. And it's an amazing scene, by the way. She bares her breast. She said, how can you kill me? I mean, I'm your mother. I, you grew inside me and all this kind of thing, and he tells her. And the reason it actually happened this way is because Athena, whose name I really can say, who's the judge in this, because then it goes to court. And the question is Orestes...
Orestes.
Good, I said the right thing. Is he guilty or is he innocent of having killed his mother? Now, he has killed his mother, so it's not like he didn't kill his mother. And what do you think the court ruling is? So the court is in a tie. And Athena, the judge, rules him
not guilty.
Not guilty. And why is he not guilty? Why does she rule him not guilty?
Following his telos.
But that was a really good guess. Absolutely wrong. Yeah, does anybody know why he's not guilty?
It's not a premeditated crime anyway.
He did it out of love for his father.
But he had time to think.
He had time to think.
But it's an act of vengeance, so... But he was also...
Mitigating circumstances.
But he was fulfilling the role as a son. The son's role to avenge his father's
death. Yeah. However, that wasn't the reason, but it was a good try. There has never been a reason given. And there's been centuries and centuries of discussion as to what was this reason, but it's called the Law of Athena. So whenever there's, nowadays in court, if there's a hung jury, the person goes innocent, goes free. It's the same idea. So if there's a hung jury, then the view... It's kind of the benefit of the doubt, but it's not even at that level. It's not like they've been found innocent because of the benefit of doubt. They've found that they can't go on in the jury because they're tied. And that's the code of Athena. That's what that's called. Now, I raise this with you because there's a parallel with little Abraham and Isaac and that whole story. Because Isaac is also going to kill his son. He's also been told, for a variety of reasons, you must go kill your son. Why is this considered even something other than utter murder? What, do you remember where we got to when we... Okay, Lily remembers. Okay, does anybody else remember? Okay, Lily, go for it. Why is he not considered a murderer at this point?
Because he's... Well, why was it the knight of faith? So he's basically... He's ruled by his dedication to God, so right now we don't think he's a murderer because of that. But it's unclear.
Okay, but we know that in the case of Orestes, he is a murderer. And certainly in the case of Agamemnon...
Oh, he doesn't kill him. He doesn't actually kill him. So
well, that's true. But he's thinking about... Okay, in the case of Agamemnon, he kills his daughter.
Well, he considers everything. So he doubts... He applies his reason to the situation. He considers every other option, and he decides that this route he's chosen to kill his son is the only option he has.
Okay. And why... What has to happen for this to not... fall in the same category of murder? What are the conditions that have to be met? What are the conditions? I mean, can you imagine, for those of you that have children, or for those of you that are still children, can you imagine being asked to kill your child and then to even consider it? What do you have? Yes, Fred.
So because he has to kind of transcend the ethical, to have an absolute relationship to the absolute. So it becomes more that Abraham will feel every bit of pain to kill his son, to sacrifice his son. So I believe that what Derrida is trying to say is that...
Kierkegaard.
No, yes.
Well, yes, no, I... Yes.
Is that if there was any part of Abraham which would have killed Isaac out of anything but love for him, then he would have failed.
Right. So Agamemnon, in parallel story, fails because he's doing it to win a war.
Yeah.
Right. So he's doing it for a human endeavor, supposedly, to win this war, even though the gods are telling him to kill. So the other thing, just of note that might be interesting for you is that one of the things that's interesting about the story is that this is also the implantation, the flagpole of a monotheistic god. That's what's going. This is a myth that's been going on for many, 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 many centuries about the killing of a child, the need to sacrifice a child in various types of religious environments, fundamentalist environments. And there is the overthrow of that view toward reason. And the reason, I don't mean the meaning, the kind of logic that's being put down like a flagpole here, the kind of logic that's being put in is one that requires some form of non-reason to form its path. Try and write that down before you weep. So the path, the dappled, beautiful sunlight path, has some dark bits to it. And that path, he's not asking Abraham to go off the path. The path itself has to be suspended somehow. The moment, the idea of reason, the kind of reason that becomes the 2,000 years of metaphysics reason. Well, skipping forward past Heraclitus. But this form of reason requires an ability to have a not part of reason involved with it. Okay, you made a face. A face was made, eyebrows went forward. So, what is a not reason? What does it mean to say that the path... Let me start again. So if we know that in linear logic, in one foot after another, to put one foot after another still means that there are breaks, right? Because it's not like one long foot, right? It's like there's one foot, then another foot, another foot, and that can create a linear path. It creates a linear path. They're linked, continuous thinking, because we know there's a goal that's coming back around and giving it its way forward. But what we have to figure out is how that break happens with each foot, or with each dappled sunlight, with the mud, smell, how those create breaks, as it were. But those breaks aren't real breaks. They're not like, there are real breaks. Those breaks don't get you off the path. They could be very horrible breaks. They could be deep breaks. They could be suspended breaks. You could be like hanging on a thread break, but you're still on the path. Another way of putting this, which may be not a good way of putting this, but I'm going to put it this way anyway, and then we'll see how it goes. There's a person named Bataille, who we'll look at later. George Bataille, Georges, G-E-O-R-G-E-S, George Bataille, B-A-T-A-I-L-L-E, George Bataille. George Bataille, who invented or called himself an experimental philosopher. It's fantastic. Now that sort of summarizes how he felt about philosophy. An excremental philosopher. And he wanted everybody to come join him as an excremental philosopher. Now part of that, as we'll find out, brings in Freud. And as we'll find out when we get to Freud next week, but when we get to Freud, one of the gifts that you can give as a child, your first gift as a child, you know what your first gift as a child is?
Shit.
Here, here's my shit. Hey, give it. It's from me, from my body. Here, I give it to you, present. Okay? And new parents are always excited about this. My child! Shit! Fantastic. And for those of you that haven't gotten past the anal phase, you are still giving shit. And that's called being an artist. And that is what Bataille meant by this. I give you my shit. Isn't it beautiful? Do you love it? Do you hate it? But it's still mine. I give it to you as a present. Okay, excremental philosophy. So Bataille argues that the mediocre is actually what is opposite of the sacred and the profane. He says that the profane, that is to say the really nasty, coarse, aggressive, raw, dirty, porn, whatever you want to call it on the one hand, or the really pristine, beautiful, religious loveliness, God, purity, on the other, they're on the same side. They're basically the same thing, argues Bataille. What's the opposite is being boring, being mediocre. The sacred and the profane are on one side, the boring and the mediocre. That's the problem. So what Bataille argues is that if you want to transcend, or if you want to get over and sort of start moving the law along, jumping, pushing that path, it's not whether or not you become more or less excremental or more or less profane or more or less a saint. You have to kill off the mediocre. You have to get rid of it. Then you can advance. So now we circle back to this famous path. Let's go back to that path. What's on your path? Is mediocrity on your path? Is like putting your feet up and watching TV on your path, eating a few pizzas. Notice I said a few. Having a beer. What's on your path? What's on your path as you get to your goal? For Kierkegaard, he's saying that the path has to include non-reason. That is to say, that path, that this thing called non-reason, we're not thinking about something rationally, is not the opposite of reason. Mm-hmm. What?
Well, maybe it would help if you would see like suspension of rational logic.
No. That is so not going to help. It will in a minute, but let's just go back. Let's try it again. We have this path. Think of your path. Smells and flowers and mediocrity and various things on your bloody path. Okay? But also on your path is nothing. The nothing is on your path. It's not outside your path. It's not beyond your path. It's also on the path. So like I said, you have one foot in front of the other. It doesn't like you have this one long foot that just goes on. You have sort of these breaks, let's say. It's still continuous logic because we've got a goal. It's still continuous even though there are these breaks. But the key here is that the non-reason, anti-reason, don't think about it too much reason, that group is still on the same side of reason. They're not opposed to each other. Yes. Let's try it again. We're almost there. And then we can talk about the suspension. Okay, ready? Ready? So, we're on our path. On our path, you stop. Let's say you're a dog, lift your leg, continue. On to another path, you see a car, you run after it, continue on your path. You stop, you take a nap, paint. These are your path, you're on your path. So it's not like you have to be doing one long thing all the time on your path. You can be doing lots of things, you're sleeping, you can be jumping up and down. You could be, you know, running after a car. You could be, like, singing. It doesn't matter what your path is. It matters that there's a goal to the path. I'm not going to get off that part of it. Just to remember that on the same path of what you think you're doing is also what you don't think you're doing. It has nothing to do with thinking on the path. Are we okay with that? Who isn't okay with that? James, you okay with that?
Please repeat.
We're almost there. I know, we're almost there. Okay. So we're on a path. Think about being on a path. And on your path, how many people have run to catch a bus recently? I never try to run to catch a bus. It always makes me so angry to catch a bus. It makes me mad that I'm even taking a bus. So then I get angry, and then it just all goes very wrong. You know, it just annoys me to run for a bus. I always think there'll be another bus coming. Of course, there never is, and you're like, okay. But you run to catch your bus. You get to your bus. You got to find your pass. You find your pass. You know, the pass is out of date. You know, whatever's going on. It's like all these complications, right? Now, in the moments on that path are also exactly at the same time moments that don't make any sense at all but are part of the path. They're part of your path. If you don't have, it's not like you're always making sense on this path. And every second, nanosecond, I make sense. So, non-reason or anti-reason or nothing to do with reason, is on the same path as going for your goal. Got it? Mm-hmm. So it's not opposite. So thinking versus practice. No. Practice and thinking are the same path. Thinking versus not thinking. Same path. It's on the same path. Got it? Simon? Sure? You sure?
Yes, I'm not sure.
Okay, very good. So you are sure. Okay, very funny. Okay, so you're on the same path. Now, go back to Abraham. And this is where Tadas wanted us to bring in this. One way of saying that is that your interpretation of this, whether or not you're being ethically correct or not, has to be suspended. It has to not come into the picture. Because if it comes into your picture on your path, it will begin to reconstruct your understanding of your path.
No, that didn't work.
Oh, okay. Okay. No.
No. Don't understand.
You have to suspend your thinking, or you have to suspend your...
Kind of both. You can't bring thinking into it 100%.
Otherwise, you'll never go for a maid. What for?
Yes.
Right, so you never actually do if you entirely...
If you overthink, it's called overthinking.
Yes.
But in fact,
yes.
it's actually just thinking.
Yeah.
So if you so-called overthink, that is to say that you think that you must have an answer for every second of the moment of the path, you're going to get a little bit tied up in that path and never actually get started on your path. The path requires that you accept that the thinking includes, as part of thinking...
Mm-hmm.
Sorry. Includes as part of thinking, not thinking.
It's
James.
Yes, obviously.
Is it?
Yes. Good.
It's funny to say that we arrive at a point when thought no longer thinking.
When thought can no longer think. Excellent.
Is that what you're trying to explain?
Yes. When thought can no longer think, but that doesn't mean it's not thought.
Okay.
Fred got this earlier and he explained it.
Yeah, Fred, go for it.
Well, it's just happened, you see, because I was going to say, if you did call on me today, that I would think, but why does my brain kind of betray me and I enter this state of not thinking when you ask me what I am thinking? So in that, by that...
Did I ask you what you're thinking?
No, but that could be different, because you are not entirely on the path, in that sense, is it?
Explain, please.
Okay.
Okay, let's try it again. We're so close. We're so close to getting this. Okay, ready? So you're on a path. Okay, you're on your little path, and you're not thinking about anything. But you are still on the path getting your MA. Now, that doesn't mean that you are without thought, but it doesn't mean that you are figuring out every step of the way. So to put it slightly differently, this path of thinking, of rational going forward, of making this happen, making this MA happen, this path of rational making it happen, includes not making anything happen. Okay? Okay, we got a couple of people nodding. I'm hoping
this is,
that...
This is such a relief. I'm so glad.
Okay, but it gets worse, so that's all right, yeah. Okay, so, but just so we're on the same path on here, the same wavelength, you're on your path. So if you want to be a proper philosopher, not that I'm suggesting you should, but hopefully by the end of this, you'll be beaten into submission. To understand proper thinking does not mean to be thinking every 5 seconds, every nanosecond, every... If you're thinking all the time, that's not thinking. Thinking requires not thinking at the same time. Not like not thinking and then thinking. And then not thinking and then thinking. It's like not thinking and thinking at the same time. Not thinking and thinking at the same time. Not thinking and thinking at the same time.
Can I bring something into it? Maybe it's more like a bicycle ride. When you start going on it, you just have to look there for your... aim.
To your goal.
And
yeah.
Try not to see around, but notice it and just
okay.
Go through it without...
I like the bike riding.
Looking. If you stop and look around, I follow you.
Yes.
That's
so, okay, so Abraham has Isaac on the handlebars. Okay. And is riding his little bike with Isaac. Not doing an overthinking bit. He knows that when eventually he gets to Mount Moriah, that changed a little bit. Gonna have to, like, I don't know, get a knife out or do something with himself. But on the path, it's thinking and not thinking that you can't take them apart. So it's not like, now I'm thinking, now I'm not thinking. Now I'm thinking, now I'm not thinking. No. It's I'm thinking and I'm not thinking at the same time. I'm now still thinking and I'm not thinking at the same time. My God, I'm still thinking and not thinking at the same time. That is thinking. Thinking requires breathing, a breath. So it requires air. Maybe that was too much for a lot. Yes. You want to explain that?
Well, if you remember when...
No.
When we started with, I think, the 4 a.m. of the car. So it is trying to look for a base from which being sure that everything that thinks and feels is certain. And we cannot trust the 5 senses because they can be deceiving, because it's eyes or senses, touch, it can be subjective at least. And the 4 is that it goes inward and it starts asking where are the ideas that I am using for my thinking coming from, and it also that is debatable. They come from outside, I have them already innate in me. Then it goes back even further and reaches this point beyond which it can no longer go, which is I am thinking. And while I am thinking, I cannot deny that I am thinking. So it is somehow almost stepping out of his own thought and seeing himself thinking. But he can't step out entirely. So it is in this continuous loop. I think, before I am. I'm thinking, I think before I am. And from that, and then it moves forward again. That's certain, and that from that on moves on. And this argument on the path retraces these between the commensurate and incommensurate.
Did that help you?
No.
Who said no? Who's admitting?
I'm
okay, yes.
I was going to ask a question at the risk of overthinking.
You can never overthink.
I'll pass on that. I'll this sort of dappled thought that you have on the path. Are we talking about all thinking or different kinds of thinking?
Ooh.
I mean, what we're doing here is representational thinking, logic or whatever, analytical type thinking.
Mm-hmm.
But there are other kinds of thinking. Is that what you're referring to? It's sort of attuning our way down the path, so to speak.
I will be referring to that, but that's a little bit later, yes.
Right. But we're actually talking about no thinking at all at parts.
Sometimes there's no thinking at all.
Nothing at all. Okay, just.
Then is that how does that link to the unconscious? Because if, for example, you know the answer to something, but you just can't think of a name or
an explanation or whatever it is, and then you just forget it for a while, and then suddenly it comes, pops up in your mind.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No. Not that type. Sometimes there's no thinking at all.
What a blessing.
What's that?
It can be a blessing.
It can be a blessing. Yes.
It might be possible.
It's the one thing I wrote down from reading Kierkegaard that I kind of went,
good.
I understand it.
Oh my God.
And I'm
going to
throw
share.
It into the ring, and then you'll go, no, that's a wish. But the ethics as such is the universal, and as the universal, it applies to everyone, which from another angle means that it applies at all times. It rests immanent on itself and has nothing outside itself that is its telos, but is itself the telos for everything outside itself.
Brilliant. Excellent. Okay, now people are going to kill you. You do realize.
Sorry.
I think that you just lost about, most of the people at this end. Do you want to translate that?
Oh, God, no.
Do you
it
know
was
what
just what you said.
That's not a translation.
The thing that I've been writing notes to myself in this is, but what does all this mean? And what does it mean to me? And what does it mean to us doing all this? And I suppose I'm going to start working with lithography,
mm-hmm.
I suppose. And I just went into the print studio earlier to work with Justin and start looking at grinding lithography stones. And so I'm going to be doing that for... And I think that's a practical example of just...
letting go.
Doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll be focusing on making sure I'm doing that right and making sure I'm moving my body right and making my arms sore and making my back sore. And out of doing that will come
something.
Whatever.
Okay.
It's like your ironing board,
what's that?
Yeah.
Wait,
yeah.
Judy had her presentation this morning and it was about one of the things.
Oh, I'm so sorry, I missed
board.
It. Sorry, I had a meeting.
It was one of the things was an ironing board, a really worn ironing board. And it turned out when Judy explained it that it's a place where she escapes, so she's doing it and thinking, and but out of that comes loads of creative ideas because she's not thinking at the same time.
That's
so
it. That makes
here.
Sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Good.
Yeah. It's getting it's
good. Say it again.
So she's ironing and doing, and there must be part of you that's actually conscious about the ironing that you're doing, so you don't burn it. But at the same time, you're also not thinking because you're creating at the same time, because in your head you've obviously got you said you write notes about it, work at the same time, yeah, so you're kind of making and practicing,
yeah.
Does it make sense, Dorothea? What did you say?
That,
what was
that? This is how I drive.
This is how you drive.
No, when you're so deep into thinking that you're not thinking about anything and you're driving and you think, God, how did I just get here?
No, you know what I mean.
Driving is something else.
That's slightly different. I mean, like, for example, did anybody see the film The Shining?
Yeah.
You know, there's a scene where he's quite mad and he's writing, this huge novel, and page after page, and it says, all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. And it says, all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy, with paragraphs indented and double spaced and single spaced, page after page, and his partner, his wife comes in, she's changed his entire life to make sure that he's okay, and that, the kids, she's taking care of the kids because he's writing his great novel, and she sneaks down and reads like a page of it, and she starts flipping through it, and she sees it says like page after page, paragraph indented, all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy, and she flips out. Now, while he's doing this all work and no play typing, this is not Julie's ironing. Okay, so don't think that just when you're doing all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. It's not like he's now actually conceived of his masterpiece. Sometimes you can do this kind of rote thing where you're not doing anything, and that's not the not thinking we're talking about, because that's absence. Whereas what you're doing is you're not thinking, something like that, right? Is that what? And that's what you were talking about.
Yeah.
Can you now, Julie? Can you explain that again? And then we're gonna have you reread your mad thing.
As the word that's coming to me is kind of coasting.
Nice.
Because I like the bicycle and the idea that you're still going forward, but there are some bits where you've got enough speed that you can take your feet off the pedals.
Yeah.
And so my ironing board is like I described it as my Archimedean bath where I'm sort of busy just doing the stuff and then suddenly something occurs and I run off and write something or I run off and do something. But it's a thinking spot. It's a place that I think, but I'm like not thinking at the same time.
That's
and
right.
Start to
now we're getting there. Because so it's not absence of thinking on any level. It's not the all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. It's not that version. It's the version that allows you, when you're coasting, let's say, to think. So can you read this sentence now and fill up the Sophies?
The ethics as such is the universal, and as the universal, it applies to everyone, which from another angle means that it applies at all times. It rests immanent on itself, has nothing outside itself that is its telos, but is itself the telos for everything outside itself.
Who knew that he was talking about ironing, right? That's good. Okay, we're going to come back to that sentence, but you're completely correct on that. Okay, just so you know. What did you
say, Dave? Actually, I think we understand. I was just going to add to it, I suppose, an example I thought of.
Go on.
Well, there was a mathematician, I wish I remember his name, who said that thinking selectively was not going to help him understand his own equations. So he went voluntarily to work at a factory, or I wish I could remember the guy's name. And he basically decided that repetitive tasks forced unconscious behaviour.
Is it Einstein working at the patent office?
It was more recent, to be honest, mate. But I'm sure he got the idea.
Same thing.
He worked at a factory. The other thing that sprung to mind was the way in which, I always go to Zen, but they have an idea in no mind. When you do something, and because your perception is selective, to truly understand to truly have a higher awareness of what's going on, you do something without trying to think of what you're doing. So you just do it, and it is the path. And the things that crop up while you're doing it are kind of help you understand the world a little better, but your awareness is greater because you're of the state of no mind. You're both thinking and not thinking at the same time.
Okay, but it's actually thinking it's differently thinking.
Yeah, it's not thinking.
It's thinking and differently
thinking.
It's not
trying to direct your thoughts.
Yeah, it's not trying to control them.
Yeah.
In that sense. Okay, now, so we're okay. We're more or less now on this bloody path with a little dappling that's going on. You know that, yes?
Just this different kind of thinking.
Okay.
As opposed to non-thinking.
Okay, which are different kinds of
thinking. I find it easier to think of working with materials rather than painting. That's a kind of thinking?
Yes.
Yeah, right, okay.
Okay. But it's a kind, so working with materials is not thinking.
Right, okay.
It's
that's
thinking
just wanted to check, yeah.
Through this thing called materials.
Yes, thinking stuff.
Thinking stuff, yeah. The stuff of thinking or something. No.
Possibly repetitive action actually opens up this flow of ideas.
Yes, and
for
so
some reason, swimming, walking.
Yes, so the ing of things. The ing, gerund, you know, walking, swimming. Talking, timing, the ing, the process, the duration.
But repetitive, not really.
Yes, but
growing
so.
But
in this moment of moving toward the goal, which comes back around and forms the ground, and then continue. That's the repeat.
Mm-hmm.
The repeat is the goal comes back around. The goal comes back around. Start goal, back around.
What happens when you reach that goal?
Well, you die.
Oh.
It's all over. Actually, that's terrible. It's been a long day. So. Let's just back up just for one little second, because there's one extra thing we need to know before we take a break. The thing we need to know before we take the break is now we've realized that the thinking includes this odd form of thinking, which is, let's say, ironing thinking, or coasting thinking, or imminent thinking. Okay, so it's also thinking. It's not opposed to thinking, it's on the other side of thinking, just like the sacred and the profane, they're not opposed to each other, they're not the same. But they're not opposed to each other, they're opposed to mediocrity. Okay, so if there's an opposition, it's not between the good and the bad, it's between good and bad, basically the same thing, opposed to mediocrity. So thinking, not thinking, in this example, means that it's a different type of thinking that's not directed thinking. But it's still on a path. So even though it's not actually directed, it's still on a path. Yes.
I don't want to jump too far ahead, but is this dialectical thinking?
Yes.
Okay.
But now, bad!
Well,
but anyway, that's right. We'll just reel that back in. Okay, now, before we get to dodge, don't think of that D word. Let's just think of the path. We're on the path. You're told, in order to get your MA, you must kill something. In order to be a real artist, in order to really do art, you have to kill the one thing that's precious to you. Since we're in the realm of art, we're not going to be talking about your son or daughter, your pet. We're going to be talking about something that would be precious at the level of, let's say, your mind, your art. Something has to be brought into submission in order of yourself, in order for you to actually produce something that is not able to be discussed, called your art. At some point, we can talk about the art, we can say what makes it work, but at some point, it hangs together without you having a rational point-for-point discussion of why it's working or why it's not working. You need to be able to understand what's getting suspended there. What's getting murdered there. When you do work, you have to somehow, I'm going to put it like this, you have to submit to this thing called art. You have to give yourself over to it, or it's not going to work. It's just going to be passion. Or it's going to be a description, or it's not going to work as a piece of art.
Mechanical.
Huh?
You'd say mechanical.
Mechanical, yes. Now, what Abraham is doing, and I realize there's a bit of a leap here, so we'll come back to it. He's got to submit, and in so submitting, enables something to take place. Not to take its place, not to take Isaac's place, but something to happen. Something happens in this submission. In the submission, which is going to be, I don't know why you're asking me of this, but okay. He's got to submit, and in order to do it, he's got to suspend the ethical position. Because if you're going to murder something, including yourself, and I don't mean literally. I mean, if you're going to, in order for you to create work, something's got to give, or it's not going to work. And that means there has to be the suspension of an ethical moment. Now I'm just going to do one more jump, because then we'll take a break. In suspending the ethical, what Kierkegaard is referring to as the teleological suspension of the ethical, something being suspended, something being momentarily done so you can do this other stuff, and then you begin again on your path. Once that's suspended, it has to be suspended so something can happen. And in the moment of suspension, the submission happens, the death happens. Something precious. Now, what I've just described to you is a secret. It not only is it a secret, it's the secret. Abraham, according to Kierkegaard, cannot tell Sarah, or indeed anybody else, what's going on because it's not tellable. It's not because he's been forbidden to tell it, or he thinks he's going to get in trouble if he tells it. What Kierkegaard is arguing is that it's not able to be told. And what you need to think about while you're running, get coffee, have a cigarette, use the loo, whatever, get air, is what does it mean to have a secret that's not tellable, that you must carry with you, that there's no way to tell your secret? It's not because you don't want to tell it, but there's something else going on about the ability to tell it, the ability to say it. Any quick questions before we take a break?
Do you know what it is but can't tell it? Or is it because you don't really know yourself what it is?
Could be both.
By killing it, or by kind of, are you exposing it?
Very good.
But it is also, in more narrow artistic terms, the intention to produce generally produces very bad work. One needs to allow the work to go wasted, wasting material, wasting time, until at some point, while having given up making something makes sense comes out of the work. And all that wastage that cannot be measured, or that is not productive in terms of direct measuring, somehow is a leap over a secret. It's this non-thinking that produces the new meaning at the end. If you want to make a direct parallel between one and the other. This is what I always heard in this.
Could it be called suspension then of linear logic, I think, as well, isn't it, at that whole moment? Suspension of linearity.
Not at this moment. No, it's suspending an ethical mood. So everything we just talked about in the other room, it means that you have to, because you're being asked to murder something. Don't take it lightly. Not just anything, it's something that's precious. It's a requirement of the move. Are you willing to take it?
I think for me where the analogy breaks down is that you're being required to submit or suspend something of your own, aren't you?
Yes.
Whereas Abraham is actually getting off his son.
Yeah, that's right. Right. We'll get back to that. Yeah, we'll get back to that little detail. Yeah, yeah. Hello. That's right. So, ready to take a break? Okay, we'll take a break.
I'll get a chair.
Well, you can get a chair, but also just keep the door. We're just reintroducing ourselves as new people. Okay, Robin has just introduced herself. Does everybody know who Robin is or where Robin's sitting? Very good. Well done. Okay. And what are you basically working on?
I'm finding myself.
Okay.
In that sort of
path.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's an obstacle.
Good. I mean, well, maybe not good. Okay. And you have no secrets.
No, not that I think I've run out.
Yeah. We'll work on that too. Okay.
Hello, I'm Jenny.
Everybody remember this is Jenny.
Hi, Jenny.
Okay. Secrets?
No.
Really? Unbelievable. Two for two. Neither of you have secrets.
I think so. No, I'm looking at you.
You sure?
Maybe. No, I don't know.
You sure? Okay, so Jenny and Robin are the two people in the entire world, and they happen to be located in this classroom, that do not have secrets. I'm very impressed. You sure?
Oh, I'll come back to you.
Okay. You sure? Jenny is absolutely certain she has no secrets. James, you better not disappoint. Do you have secrets? Wait, your name first.
I'm James, anyway. I wouldn't say I don't have any secret, but it becomes secret when it comes out of me, or someone has discovered what it is my secret.
Oh, that's nice. Very good. We have Kierkegaard here. James Kierkegaard. Okay. Good.
Hi, I'm Tadas. I finished this course last year and I'm crazy enough to come back. Preparing for, hopefully, for PhD with Johnny. And yeah, secret is the, for me, you know, like when you do art, you know, like, and Well, you're in.
No, no, I'm not asking for a general definition of secret. Do you have a secret?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to share it?
I can't. Not because I don't want to.
It will not be a secret if he, he shares.
It wouldn't be that secret, maybe. If I would try to share it, it wouldn't be that.
So, try and share it.
Can't begin to put it into words.
Okay.
I'm Tom, and I've got no secrets as well.
Oh my god! What's wrong with this row? Except for James. Okay, I don't mean what is wrong. I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean that in the best way positive. Jamie, you sure you know the secret? Okay. Okay, Tom, do you really not have any secrets? You don't have to tell us what it is.
I might have one or two.
One or two?
Yeah.
Okay, from none to one or two. Excellent. Well done. Okay, person in the back who shall not be named. Starts with a D.
Yeah, I've got a secret. I'm not going to.
Yeah, but could you tell the secret if you wanted to?
No.
You sure?
You have to kill me.
Oh.
Wow, that's... Okay. Okay. Okay, can you give us a hint? No. Okay.
I'm Deborah.
Do you like to be called Deborah or Debbie?
Deborah, please.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Ever since somebody said Debbie does Dallas, and I figured out what that was, I changed the name Debbie, so it's Deborah. I haven't even investigated further. I've just, it's in the title, really, isn't it? I'm Deborah. I'm investigating the derelict housewife and the decline of the stay-at-home mum within my work.
The decline of the stay-at-home mum, what a
yeah,
great title!
Basically because I was a single mum for 11 years, and that motherhood bit and the struggles and stuff are important to me, and I think there is an importance there. And yeah, I've got some great secrets. 11 years single mum, yeah, I've got some good secrets.
Okay, can you tell any?
No.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If you felt more comfortable, could you tell it?
If I felt more comfortable, in what way?
In the way that it could tell your secret.
Probably, yes. But my husband doesn't even know my major secret, so...
Okay, I think you should stop this.
It's not illegal, it's not really bad, it's a pride thing, I think.
Interesting.
God, that sounds really bad, I'm shutting up.
No, it doesn't sound bad at all. It
no,
sounds
yeah.
exactly what
it's
important to know about.
Yeah.
Mm, good.
It's a pride thing, I think, more than anything.
That the secret is that you have pride.
Yeah, I have pride, and it's something that I struggle to disclose, you know, to say, because it's...
Well, that's very
yeah,
brave.
It's not a bad thing, by the way. It's
no,
just,
no.
I think after being an 11 years single mum, it's a struggle and crap that you go through, really, and the sides that people don't see.
People don't see.
Yeah.
Would you say that that's the secret?
Sometimes, yeah, definitely.
So
it's related to the secret.
So
yeah.
The sides that people don't see, so the people, whoever these people are, let's say the community that you live in or whatever, that they don't see something, but you know it exists.
Yes, definitely.
So
yeah.
It's a secret that's out in the present, that's out in the open, but people
yeah.
don't see it.
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're getting warmer.
I'm probably not alone. It's probably a massive shared secret and problem for a lot of people. God, it sounds bad. I've gone from Debbie Dallas to secrets. It's
yeah.
Like,
right.
Dragging me up.
In,
yeah. No,
Deborah in the darkness.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great.
Debbie the dark. Yeah.
Debbie. Okay.
Aunt Alu.
Secrets?
Yes. Yes, Liz. But yeah, I do think in some ways, I'm quite transparent, but in a good way. But I can be a sneaky little bastard as well.
Okay.
At times, quite sneaky. And secretive, sneaky.
Okay, and what? How do you mean secretive then at that point?
Secretive, hiding things, concealing,
okay.
More personal sort of things that I do in other ways, try to be quite open.
Okay.
And in that sense, everyone is, because we don't all know everything about each other, so people, we
so
make a conscious choice to hide certain things about ourselves in certain contexts. So everybody is secretive in that sense.
Okay. Do you have a big secret though? Like a big...
Sometimes I used to have things where I thought, like, oh my god, it's a really big secret. But then when you look back on it, you're like, oh, it's not even that bad. No, not like a really life-shatteringly devastating secret. But a myriad of little...
Probably little secrets.
Sneaky little secrets, yeah.
Okay, all right.
I'm Fred, of course. I, yeah, have secrets.
So this back row is the row of secrets. This side row, James, no secrets. And can you go any further than that?
Well, I think for me, in terms of like a secret for myself, which is about myself, but I cannot fully understand it myself, would be to kind of like how I make art or why I do what I do. So that is a secret to me, but it is also a secret that, you know, the universe obviously don't understand either, so it's impossible for me. Maybe I will understand it someday, or maybe the whole point of it is I will never understand it. So it will always be a secret, but it will always be something that is trying to get out of me, or trying to push forward, that kind of quest.
A weird little animal.
Yeah.
Okay, Panos?
I have
secret
too.
It's the back row secret group. Yeah, you want to share any of them?
No.
How about just one?
Actually, it's one. But
you just have one.
Yeah, it's one, but it's many forms.
Oh, that's great. So that you have one secret, but it takes on many forms.
Mm.
And does it haunt you, the secret? Does it bug you? Does it annoy you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Every day.
And you don't want to give us a hint.
It's about an experience.
Okay.
Emotions.
Emotions. Okay. Could you put it into words if you felt like it?
I think you can put it in words, but unless if it's not a similar experience of the other one.
Okay.
You can't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's about that.
Good.
I'm Nadia. Officially I'm Nadezhda, but I still have calls as Nadia. Now I have a desire to sign my work. I'm a painter. Doro. Which
Doro.
Is very neutral. It's neither man, neither woman, and it comes from Dorothy. Because everybody asked me, why did you go on this course? Why did you go? So I had to justify myself. To myself, first of all. So now I'm writing Doro.
Doro. So would you like to be called Doro?
Sometimes in art world.
Shall we call you Doro?
Please. Yeah.
Okay, everybody.
Doro.
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 Doro. Everybody. Okay, I like
not
that.
Dodo.
No, not Dodo. You shouldn't have done that. That's very bad. Okay, do you have a secret?
A lot.
Put it like a main one.
Oh, main. There is no main. I always laugh at them. But I can bring something.
So you see Jordan laughing to herself, we know. She's secretly dealing with her secrets, yes.
I can formulate one, but it's... if you tell a secret, it's not a secret. But it's... Maybe like that. I don't like to say how many times I was married.
It's more than okay, one. So we know.
It's another secret.
But that's a secret that could be found out if someone really wanted to do investigative research.
Well, yes, everything can be found out.
No, but that's
sometimes.
The point of this particular secret.
Oh.
This secret cannot be found out, not even if you were tortured.
I also have those.
Okay. That's really very helpful. Excellent. Okay. Can you give us a hint?
Progressing towards the end of the life.
That's right. You're not progressing towards the end of the life, for God's sake.
Of course I'm progressing.
Okay, in that sense. All progressing. Anyway, okay, now let's bring the tone back to happiness. Okay, yeah, okay, so, yes, okay.
I'm Lulu. My name is Ada. It's really hard to pronounce, or Lulu.
Ella, it's not that hard.
It's Ada.
Okay, it could be hard. Okay, now, do you prefer to be called Lulu?
That's fine, yeah. It's my nickname.
Okay, good. But you're new to the course, right?
I was here last week.
Well, I didn't have it. Basically new. And what do you think? What are you doing?
No idea.
Okay, good. Excellent. Well done.
Speak to him later.
I speak to him. Do you? Yeah. Okay. Do you have any secrets?
Yeah. Everyone does.
So no, not everyone.
No.
It turns out there's at least three people here that do not have secrets. Do you think that's true?
My opinion, no.
Okay. So, and are you an artist?
That's a really hard question. I don't know.
Okay.
No idea.
Okay.
I'd like to call myself that, but...
And what do you...
Well, I study graphic design.
I was going to say, how did you end up in this building? Graphic design.
Yeah. I'm doing my MA in fine arts. And art and design, sorry.
Whichever.
Right?
Yeah, good.
Yeah. So, secrets. Basically, I don't tell my secrets. Well, I can tell whoever I want, whenever I want. It just depends on... Basically, I don't want anyone to hold anything against me.
So that you won't say anything then that could jeopardize you.
Exactly.
So the secret then is something that will protect you.
Exactly, yeah.
It's
protection. So holding onto a secret is to protect.
I'm holding on to no secrets.
You're holding on to no secrets. All right. Okay. Okay.
So,
Pilot?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, name?
I think we all have secrets.
No, but name?
Pilot. But you just said
I know.
My name. I thought it wasn't necessary.
Yeah, you were right, but anyway. So, yeah, do you have a secret?
Yes.
Do you want to share it?
No.
Do you want to give a hint?
No.
Do you want to give a hint?
But there are different levels of secrets.
Do you have more than one secret?
Well, we all do.
I'm only interested in the really serious secret. Like the big secret, the big S secret.
What's a secret?
Yeah, that's a big one.
What's
a secret? And
what is it?
Hold on.
What you think is a secret and like a really big secret.
But is
might
secret
be actually...
is secret something that will protect you, so that becomes a secret?
Mm-hmm.
Or is secret something that is not tellable?
It's both on different levels.
Okay.
Because a secret can be what will either protect you or protect someone or something that you care about.
Okay, so the secret also has to do with caring. So not telling something is not just about protecting. It could also be about caring. Like you don't want to hurt, yeah.
But it doesn't have to be that either.
Okay.
Because the secret you have could also be a secret to you in the sense that you have no...
access to it.
Yes, there's no access to it.
Is that a secret?
Yes,
it's still a secret. It's a lack of knowledge.
But if you have knowledge, if you have come to the conclusion, but you cannot explain your process to that conclusion, if you know something but you can't say why, then it's a secret to you.
Excuse me, a secret in a different way. In my opinion, secret is when you know something, as somebody else try to know something else about what you know that you have concealed, it becomes a secret.
Okay, so let's follow that again. So you know somebody who knows something about you, who knows something that you might have done,
which you have concealed,
which you concealed
without telling him,
yeah,
it becomes a secret. Because what you have in you, without saying it, has become part of you, and you are conscious of that.
So it requires a secret, requires a public.
So if anything concealed is then a secret, is it?
Yeah, something that you
conceal. No, it has to be concealed from something. Yeah. It's not just that it's concealed. It could be concealed from yourself.
Yeah.
Okay, is that, you agree with that, Violeta?
Oh, it's complicated.
Yes, of course it's complicated. That's this class.
So did you know that project, Post Secret?
What? Whose project?
There's a project by a man called Frank Moore.
It's
been going
Moore.
On for ages.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
So would you consider those secrets, the ones that people send in?
Yes,
no.
Because they're anonymous, aren't they?
Anonymous? We're getting so warm. We're getting so warm. We have no answers yet. Hold on.
Are they almost, if it's a secret that's told, is it like a confession? You know, once it's out in the open.
Could
what you're talking about then about that, is that like a confession? I don't know.
It would still be a secret even if you tell, because what otherwise, how does gossip work? You're a secret.
Yeah, it's about being anonymous.
As long as someone's excluded, then it's a secret.
Is it a secret if you tell somebody that you've asked to conceal it from other people?
Yeah, no, this is good. This is good. We're getting the.
It's mine because nobody else. No, well, it's
Robin.
Except you know the secret.
Confessions at lunchtime.
You know her secret, but that's not yours.
Oh,
so
yeah.
You have a secret, but it's your
so,
holding
yeah,
secret.
So yeah, she knows my secret. So yeah, it's no longer my concealment. It's a secret for Robin to keep.
But then, okay.
Is it a secret as long as the person it concerns doesn't know it's a secret?
Well, we'll get to that. Why didn't Abraham tell Sarah what was going on?
Because she wouldn't understand.
She wouldn't believe it.
She wouldn't. It hasn't the power of meaning for her
she
as it would for him.
Now, honestly, if you were Sarah and
she would have stopped
him.
She might
have
talked.
She might have stopped him.
Yeah.
She might have like killed him.
Yeah. Yeah.
She might have had an issue with it. I think she would have understood perfectly well.
No, I didn't mean it like that.
Yeah.
I meant. Yeah, you go on. Yeah, yeah, it's fine.
So
I didn't mean it like that. Sorry, that wasn't very well worded.
No, go on.
How could he explain, like we're saying, how can I put into words my secret, my concealment? How is he going to explain that to her?
Where she
that's
will
away
go
from
along
ethics,
with it,
to where
one.
She'll go and she'll understand that that's...
I see.
That's
yeah,
what
yeah,
he
sorry.
Has to do.
Yes,
sorry.
Right.
Can.
I didn't mean yes, she'll understand
no,
go ahead
yes,
and do
yes,
it.
Yes,
I
yes,
meant,
yes.
Yeah, good point.
There
yeah.
is a line about this.
What page is that?
In this edition is page, you can see it without glasses, 113. It's more or less halfway through the chapter.
What
did you say? It is speaking of the tragic hero, so it's still going through the example of the aesthetic. But it says, the reason for his silence would not be a wish to place himself as a single individual in an absolute relation to the universal, but to be placed as a single individual in an absolute relationship to the absolute.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Read that again.
The reason for his silence.
No, it's in Kierkegaard.
Would not be a wish to place himself as the single individual in an absolute relation to the universal, but to be placed as a single individual in the absolute relationship to the absolute.
Mm. Say it one more time.
So the reason for his silence would not be a wish to place himself as a single individual in an absolute relation to the universal.
So what does it mean to say an absolute relation to the universal? What does that mean?
Me?
Yeah,
well, the universal is the one that is shared by everyone and communicated with everyone. So
yes.
He would like to have a private access.
And
it
also has ethics.
Sorry?
And universal, we mean also ethics.
Yes,
yes,
that's the realm in the regime of situation of ethics. So in having an absolute relationship to the universal would be to have a private and imperfect and direct relationship to it, a privileged relationship to it, but still in a regime that is communicated and communicable. So everything that happens in the universal ethics can circulate.
Yes.
He doesn't want to do that. He wants to be placed as a single individual. Once he's alone, in an absolute relationship, once again alone, to the absolute, again something that cannot be communicated or divided or mediated, it just is.
Alone.
So it's, and that's
yes.
the thing that I find very interesting. If I have to answer, I've got to
see.
It's
very high position.
Yes.
Which?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Say it again, Mattia? No,
but,
so
but if I had to answer the question, I've got the secret. Because at the moment I'm trying to write a thesis, so I'm trying to really explain and communicate a lot. My secrets are really hiding deep from me at the moment.
Yeah.
Really, they are almost unreachable. Because I am all about putting out things. And there is something which for me has been saying that moment is working, which
yeah.
you don't articulate in the language. That's really hiding.
Yes.
I mean, I hope it will come back in the text of the thesis, but
let's not go
to
your thesis. Yeah. Amrit.
On secret day.
Okay, this is Amrit.
So my name is Amrit, and I remember thinking about this last year when I came. I don't even know if I should say this, because this is almost the secret in itself. But okay, yes, I have secrets. No, they're not like life changing, but they're still pretty big ones to me. But I find that. I couldn't tell anybody because they're so much part of me that if I was to, I'd be letting part of me go.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't. They're mine, and they're not. Like they're just they make me too much for anybody else to know it or to have it.
Mm-hmm. So, in a certain sense, you know what your secrets are. At least you know this group of secrets. You're not like in the Mattia group of secrets.
I think it took a while to find them. They're so buried.
Yeah.
That you don't realise how much of a part of you they are until you really start thinking about it. Mm. So, but those that the ones that I currently know, then yes, they are.
Mm-hmm. Which
so
is
you can have secrets too, but they're buried from yourself.
Well, what Leotard says, which is part of the seminar, is that. A person who does not know how to hide does not know how to love. And the translation to that tends to be not, you know, can you sneak around from people that you love and then that preserves them from knowing things. It's not that. It's rather, can you get in touch with the most innermost things that make you you, or at least know that they sort of exist, but you maintain them to yourself, and in so doing, it allows you to love. Not so much it allows you to be loved. It's not like you're trying to keep away all the evil things so that nobody knows about it. It's rather that, like just what Amrit was saying, you keep to yourself the things you begin to learn about yourself because they allow a certain kind of way in which you develop love. Something like that. Does that make sense to you?
Yes. Not entirely. I don't understand how love could develop out of that. Well, is it out of an acceptance that you know
yes.
how to hide?
Yes.
Acceptance. Yeah.
Yes, the acceptance of having to not tell.
Then yes, that makes sense.
Okay, we're getting there. Okay.
Nick. I'm Nick. I think it's... you can't possibly know whether you you can't say I have no secrets, but you don't know your own secrets. I mean, I can. We, as we come around the corner, we sort of.
That's right. This is a big
down
secret
further,
room.
Aren't we? So
that's right.
This is a different conversation.
So sitting down in the couch.
So I wouldn't accuse anybody over that side of sort of dissimulation because they don't have any secrets because we're talking about something else once we come around here. But
he's trying to be nice now.
Well, no, I think that's right. I'm aware that I'm sort of driven by things which I'm not aware of, and I'm not precisely sure what they are. I can sort of
but you see, Abraham in this example is aware.
He's aware.
Being
yes.
driven.
Well,
so
I think there are different kinds of secrets. There's the secrets you can never know that you know sort of thing.
Don't quote
Rumsfeld. I don't know who I'm quoting now. I was thinking with Freud
for this course,
isn't it? I mean, repression and all that sort of thing. I mean, to repress memories that are repressed, you have to put a lot of energy into that. So it's not just a question of not knowing. You're keeping them, you know, you're sitting very hard on them.
Yeah.
Yet you don't have access to them.
Right. Right.
And then there's the sort of, what I regard as the sort of kindergarten secret, you know, where we're talking about something that's very personal to us, and for me at the moment, I'm thinking about research and practice, you know, and how my thing is about relating to sort of landscapes and things, which I'm getting closer to being able to explain to myself, and hence I hope I'd be able to explain it to other people. So that, there's no reason why, I don't think, why I'd want to keep that secret nevertheless. It's just sort of a question of prizing it out somehow.
Okay, but the secret that is being sort of discussed at this point cannot be, it's not like it should not be shared.
Mm.
It cannot be shared. But the key is that a secret depends on its shareability.
Mm.
So you're keeping something from,
I think, if I, yes,
the outside, as it were. But there's like in the case of Panos and Amrit, it's something that, in keeping the secret, it allows one to love, allows one to hide in a way that produces a positive move.
I need to know more what you mean by that, allows one to love. You know, it's a sort of the L word.
Sorry.
What point did I say? I tend to be a bit more sort of concrete than that. So I have to have some sort of idea of what it is we're getting at.
Robbie, not chair.
You need to be a bit more specific for me it's just too bland, you know what I mean? For Leotard to say that. If you think you know,
complete Nick comment.
if you think
probably the most unbland thing that's ever been said.
let me just spit it out. If you think you know the meaning of that, you're deceiving yourself. I would say.
Hence, not bland.
Okay, Simon.
I'm Tom. Have I got secrets? Well, yes. I don't know whether they're of the same magnitude that Abraham's been. I was sort of thinking of, I mean, the stuff that I don't want to tell people, but part of that may be ineloquence on my part, to a degree. But also there is some sort of resistance to that unconcealment or revealing.
Mm.
And I was sort of trying to sort of burrow down into it and trying to work out where the ineloquence or the lack of words or something changed into that, just that stopping, almost. Because I think they are two different things. I don't know.
Well, once I can talk properly.
Okay, yeah.
Would you think that your sound piece that you did today was one big secret?
Well, you see, I got into that. Joe was asking me about intention, and I was just like,
you're getting more and more annoyed. I saw that.
I was. Just not in a bad way, because it's something that I kind of always need to address. But I always get that sort of, I do get tongue-tied about it. But also, I do think there's an importance in the fact that I can't quite get there, and those two things are two different things.
Right, yeah.
I could, like my personal secrets, I could put them into words. Mm-hmm. There are words that would enable me to express it.
Can you give us a hint?
But there is nice subtle under the radar there. But there's something extra kind of behind all that, behind all the words, that is more, has more weight to it, something I think. I don't know.
Okay. Yes.
I'd like to share a secret. Well, it's not really a secret.
Okay, then.
But it is to some people. I'm hiding it from them.
Okay, you do realize we're on the web.
No. It's not.
So really? Now you're not going to share it?
No, because I thought it was only us.
It's only us.
Mm.
Are they ever going to watch it?
Mm,
Yeah, just turn off the camera for a second.
What confessions is this?
I think this boss is sending me mad already because I'm actually trying to classify my secrets in my head. And there's kind of, I feel like there's secrets that are things that I might have done or said, and then there's secrets that are kind of elements of my personality that I might conceal. So I was kind of like categorising them. I think I'm going mad. And then there's also secrets that other people have told me, so they're not my secrets, but I'm kind of like.
But you're holding them. You're like secrets, the cabinet of secrets, you know. Ed, can you share any? Okay, the ones that are really, let's say, borderline powerful, so in that category, what are they more or less about?
I can't say.
You can't say or you won't say? It's like cooking.
Both.
Can't cook, won't cook. My line.
I won't say, I suppose. I could say.
You could say.
Choose not to.
But you're choosing not to. Do you have any secrets that you also couldn't choose to say, that they're just not sayable?
No, I wouldn't say them.
If you chose to say them. Okay. So, because that is Abraham. Abraham could say it, if he could say it. Except he chooses not to say it, but then even if he did say it, it probably wouldn't be heard. Mm. So it's kind of almost like Cassandra. Oh, we're back to this. Honest is going to be our...
Cassandra.
Oh. This is Julie. Everybody here, Julie.
I have a lot of secrets.
A lot?
Yes.
That's exhausting.
I can
it is exhausting.
You can compete. That's hilarious.
It is exhausting. It was exhausting. Well, don't get to wear it down without a few secrets, too. I can say one secret, which I think was fairly important, because it doesn't apply now.
Okay.
A friend asked me to keep a secret that... some people in her family were in the SAS, and I kept the secret, and I never said anything. They no longer are doing that, so that's a relief kind of thing.
Right.
Because when somebody volunteers information that you don't actually want to hear,
yes,
and then they tell you that you can't tell anybody, that's quite a burden.
Yes.
Because, you know, and that's the kind of wild horses wouldn't drag from you type of secret. And I kept the secret. I'm actually very good at keeping secrets, and people tell me a lot of their secrets.
Note. Okay, yes.
Something to do with reflective listening, which I learned in parenting class.
What is reflective listening? I've never heard of that.
It's where you say to me, I don't really understand what that's about, so I start to explain, and you get comfortable with me, and then you tell me all your secrets.
Oh, wow.
Because I'm reflecting the things
process
that you are saying, and therefore that comfortableness allows people to feel comfortable.
In other areas, that's called being a leak. Seriously. I used to work for the State Department at one point, and they have various levels of clearance of secret clearance. So if you tell a secret, if you tell someone something they don't need to know, which is not quite a secret, but if you tell them something they don't need to know, they know that they don't need to know it. So if they've heard something that they don't need to know, they can then go to somebody else and say, I've heard something that I don't need to know that so-and-so told me. And the person that would tell the thing that you didn't need to know, they would be charged with being a spy or a leak. And you could get 18 years in prison for that. It's an actual law called the need-to-know law. So if you ever tell anybody something they don't need to know, then that person either maintains it as a secret.
On government level?
Government, yeah. Yes. So for example, if I tell you something, I think I've told you this before, but certainly told other classes before. There was... one of the things I did at the State Department was I was what they called a congressional liaison, which basically meant that you lobbied illegally the Congress. You talked to congressmen and women and you got them to change their votes because the government would have certain policies. And one of the policies was that the Suez Canal, not Suez Canal, Panama Canal, there were some issues around it. So the government decided that they should think about giving the canal back to the Panamanians. And what my role was to talk to various people and get them to think this was a good idea. And I kept saying, but why, you know, what's behind this? I mean, you know, because normally people, if they have property, they don't want to give it away. They don't do that. And it turned out it was because the Navy had built their whole submarine fleet, nuclear submarine fleet, 1 foot too wide and couldn't fit through the canal, which is like so fantastic an argument. It's like, in case you're ever wondering, sometimes it's not a conspiracy. Sometimes just stupidity, you know, like that's one of those times. Anyway, so now I've told you something that you don't need to know. You never needed to know this, and I've now. So if this hadn't been declassified information, I would be charged with being a spy or being a leak, because I would have told you something you didn't know, and you could have had the right to go and tell on me, as it were, and say, well, you know, Johnny just kind of thing. So it's
I felt that information shouldn't have been told to me.
The SAS stuff.
Yeah. But nevertheless, I kept it.
Uh-huh. But why do you think that you're able to tell it now that they're not in the SAS?
Because there is no secret. There is no secret to keep.
But they were in the SAS.
That's fine. That's absolutely fine.
And that's known that they were in the SAS.
No, it's not known that they're in the SAS, but they no longer do that job. Therefore, their security is not at risk.
We should have probably turned that off.
That's who they are. That's the.
I haven't told you who they are.
No, and no one will find out.
So it's a hypothetical, as far as anybody knows.
Yes.
So.
Okay.
Hanan. I think I have some.
Does everybody? Can everybody hear the name Hanan?
Yeah, I think I have some secrets.
Yeah, this is the whole secret crowd. Okay, good. Yeah, can you tell anyone?
No, but I think the more significant ones have kind of confused me as to whether or not they're actual secrets, because they're more like my perception of what people have told me is a secret that I wouldn't share.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, to kind of.
Are there family secrets? Families,
yeah,
often have secrets.
Family related, but I mean they're not secrets. They're just, I don't know how to explain.
Okay. Well, we'll let you off the hook. I'm not gonna, because we're just running out of time. We gotta. Yes. Okay.
Cheers. I've got loads of secrets.
any that you would categorize with Robin, like, could you have different levels?
Yeah, oh yeah, well I was kind of thinking that, like, the sex, drug and rock and roll secrets. Well, there's usually somebody else involved in those. On some occasions there were quite a lot of people involved, so it's not a secret at all. But you know, I suppose it made me think that that's a bit of a secret. I grew up as a gay boy in the 1970s, and so I spent my whole life
being a secret.
Mm. So until I was, I suppose admitted it to myself when I was 13, maybe, actually kind of semi out loud in my head, and then later on to other people. So I suppose that's my kind of experience of living with a secret.
And then you had the secret, especially in the 70s and the 80s and 90s and until pretty much very recently, I would guess, well, probably not, let's say the 90s, where you were not in a secret with the community, as it were, or with, like, a, you know, some of the scene, but at the same time, you were a secret. Because wherever else you'd be, either it wouldn't be recognized, because even if you told people, they wouldn't believe it, or there was no way to tell it. Is that?
I suppose I've always been in a very open, accepting kind of community.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been with my partner for almost 26 years, so he's a bloke. You know, it's pretty obvious to anybody who looks, you know. I suppose there's a thing of, it's not a secret, but, you know, it's that you go through a coming out process.
Uh-huh.
Fairly regularly, you know, it's not unusual for people to go, oh, la la la, this is my husband. Oh, okay. And it's not a secret, but it's a.
Although that's very recent, the whole, you know, civil partnership marriage thing.
Yeah.
And did you find that the change in law made it easier or different or something else?
Not really, because we've been together for 26 years, and so I think that length of time, boyfriend, is a bit weak, really, as a term. This is my boyfriend of 19 years. So I've always, well, I actually refer to him as the wife.
Uh-huh. And does he refer to you that way as well?
He refers to me as the wife.
Yeah.
His colleagues refer to me as the wife, you know, it's like that kind of thing. But we're actually getting married next month, but it's going to cost us £4. You can do it. We had a civil partnership 8 or 9 years ago, but you do an upgrade for the it's called an upgrade, and you pay £4 and you have to take a gas bill.
What?
And I don't think it specifically has to be a gas bill, but you have to take a utility bill with your name and address and £4 in cash.
Wow, to be upgraded.
It's
to
so glamorous, yeah.
Wow.
That's equality for you.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, but what are your real secrets?
I'm not telling you that. Actually, if you got me over a bottle of wine or two, I'd tell you almost everything.
No, he wouldn't.
He wouldn't.
Just
try.
Okay.
Okay.
I have many secrets. I think that there are secrets which you can't tell. I can't tell you for the reason that I think that it would damage your experience. Not necessarily that you would judge me differently, but that it would cause a negative effect upon the room. It's one kind of secret. The other kind of secret is the kind that I have where I can't tell them because I know they'll be misunderstood. Not necessarily that I think there was some kind of murder or some self-esteem issue, none of that. I know it'll be misunderstood. Because in telling the secret, they will know the pain that I've kept before expressing it, you see? So they're the kind of secrets I have. But I won't tell them because I care about them.
Okay.
And therefore I'm allowed to love, I suppose, in the Italian
way. Okay, can you give us a hint?
I think that so the first kind are kind of experiential, things that I can't change about my experience, and therefore people often pity you. The second kind are things that you kind of intuitively feel. So for instance, if I was to genuinely feel as if, how do I put it, I loved someone more than they loved me, and genuinely felt this, but then kind of went through exercises of somehow proving that. That would be so sick. but then to actually kind of affirm that in your own head and say it out loud, especially to the person, would be cruel. But you kind of, the cost of you doing that is harm for them, so you love them so much you won't tell them. Even if the love you was incomparable in your own deluded mind, and you never understand their own love by definition, you kind of just understand that you should never ever express that, even if it's just a thought, even if it's just an expression of doubt. It's too cruel to say aloud.
That you're not sure you love them?
That I know both that I love them more than they love me, and that secondly, I'm not sure that amounts to a great deal. That's the kind of secret I think. I had time, man. So that's the kind of secret.
I think it's important to show people you love them when you're genuine.
But if sincerity is misunderstood, what's the point?
But how can you assume that you know the amount of love?
Yeah.
No, I know
it
will be misunderstood.
It makes you out as
not
being
as
very
that.
Seeing yourself as very much inflated.
Yeah, sure.
If you
no
think
God.
That your love is so great and pure,
hence
that this other person's love towards you isn't.
Hence, I'll be misunderstood.
Okay.
Point made. That's interesting. Guess, go on.
I'm James, and I've got lots of secrets.
Excellent. Okay, this is the lots of secrets side. I expect the last two of you will also have lots of secrets.
But I want
to
leave
that. Go on.
So they're from very small and mundane to very large.
And are you, in those small and mundane ones, let's start with that one. Can you tell anyone?
I can, but they're not very interesting. So
that's right. Give it a go.
I call my neighbours by different names.
And not to their face.
No, not to their face. No.
Yeah.
Can you tell us what names
they deserve? They deserve, it's okay.
No, they're really nice people.
people.
Can you give like a name?
Scary Claire and Johnny John.
Fantastic. Uh-huh. What about slightly more secret? That's a good mundane one. I mean, if that's mundane, that's fabulous.
Yeah, I can't say.
But Scary Claire and Johnny John John, that's pretty good. Do you have other names for other people like in the class?
No.
Oh, yes, I think.
Do you ever have those moments where you nearly call it to them back to their face? Or have actually? Yes.
And do they know that?
No.
Yeah, see, that's the great thing with those kind of secrets.
Just talking about some other Claire. Who's scary.
That's great.
Johnny, remind that camera is still rolling, you know.
Yeah, that's
like,
right.
Let's remind ourselves.
That's right. Yes, it's all right. We have the camera rolling, yeah. We can always excise out things if you have to.
I'm Nisha. I don't really, same as Lulu really, it's more kind of family secrets, more than anything, like maybe culture and traditions have created boundaries.
So you're also doing
the
thing that can't be discussed but probably is being happening. You're doing that as well?
Probably.
Mm. Okay, got to talk to you two. I mean, you know, that is a problem with the lungs, you know, I mentioned.
Oh, no, sorry, no, not that.
Oh, not that?
No,
ah.
But it's something else.
Uh-huh.
I've kind of like gone against. So I guess in a way it's a secret to my family, but it's not a secret to certain people.
Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like the coming out thing. You're like, you live a certain life.
Yeah.
But not quite. It's like a secret, but not totally a secret.
Yeah.
Okay. And what about, and then the next level up secrets. So you're right, there are these different levels.
I don't really know. I haven't actually thought about that.
Okay, well, you've had
I don't
25 minutes of
that. Yeah, I'm trying to link, but I don't think I actually have those kind of secrets.
Okay,
yet.
You belong in the side of the room. Sorry. Okay, that's good.
I'm Lily. I've got some secrets to tell. But I think after what people have been saying, if you know the unsayable secret, if you know your secret, then you know yourself. So I don't think I know that yet. I haven't really worked out what it is that I can't express though, that is my essence, maybe.
Do you think that one needs to have a secret? Like there's a need for a secret?
Maybe not, but I think maybe everyone does on some level. And you don't maybe don't need to know it.
Do you think animals have secrets? Like a dog or something?
No.
Well, I think but maybe like with in a sense with children who are uninhibited by the things we inhibit ourselves with, maybe children don't have secrets.
Oh yeah, right.
They do. They have small secrets, but not
small
secrets.
They can sweep and
yes, no, then they
sweep.
Yes, but maybe they're. Have still have or animals equating children with animals maybe not so good, but the ability to not feel the need to conceal it or the fear even, because if with great or with artists is it as people established artists, real artists, I don't know, the fear of by creating work that you're putting your secret out there and the danger of it being misunderstood or it being understood and then your secret being taken away, like I said earlier.
So now we come back, Mattia.
I was saying earlier that since I'm trying to find the thesis, I'm going through an exercise of telling everything, saying it all, and my secrets are really high and deep and in dark places.
Yeah. There's an old saying about whoring, about being whore, which is reveal everything, say nothing, or tell everything, reveal nothing. Mm-hmm. So it's tell everything, reveal nothing. So you can go completely to being completely naked, and still not reveal anything. Yes.
So is this about speaking
non-truths? No. Why would it be speaking a non-truth?
I don't know, because you're continuing to
conceal your secret. You're saying something, but you aren't.
But you're just not saying everything. You're not saying
yeah.
the whole truth.
No, we're going to get back to the thinking, not thinking, or thinking, unthinking. Let's say, or thinking, a thinking, and a thinking. Let's say thinking and then a dash thinking, because I don't want it to be the opposite of thinking. Those two things are thinking. So it's not like truth, not truth. It's truth, some other form of truth, the secret truth. And they stick together, and they do something on your path. So, but it gets back to James's question that he raised earlier. It's James, which is, well, really, what does one really mean by secret? That's when you started to answer that question. So let's segue into Kierkegaard. If you just bring that out for a second. Oh, no, not Kierkegaard, sorry. If you turn to Derrida's question. It is a... So if we turn to page 73 on Derrida. Now,
our reader, can you read that?
Yeah.
On the idea of secrecy, if you can read now, what I need on seriously.
I can't see. I have a black line.
Okay.
But don't worry, it's fine. Appreciate it.
All right. So this is on page 73 of Derrida's The Gift of Death. Now he gets into Agamemnon and so on, and what he's doing is talking about the difference between the tragic hero, the one who has a secret and then is forced to tell the secret, and then that versus the Abraham secret, which we still haven't quite come to grips with yet. Go for it. It starts with the idea of secrecy. I don't believe you can actually see that screen.
I can. Sadly, it's gone back 2 pages. Okay, good. Okay, I'm on it. Okay. The ideas of secrecy and exclusivity, non-partage, are essential here, as is Abraham's silence.
Okay, a little bit slower.
Sorry.
And this time, as though you're going to get an award.
Okay, sure. The ideas of secrecy and exclusivity are essential here, as is Abraham's silence.
Okay, so what is essential here?
Ideas of secrecy.
And?
The silence.
What's that?
The silence.
Yeah, so we've got exclusivity and silence. I want you to remember these things. So on the one hand, the ideas of secrecy as requiring some kind of barrier, or let's say you're only invited to a certain group of people who can know it, the exclusive group. That group is part of the tragic hero group. Versus the silent type of secret that can't be said, even if it's said out loud, no one can hear it. No one can partake in it. Okay, so go ahead.
Yeah, sure. He doesn't speak. He doesn't tell his secret to his loved ones. He is, like the knight of faith, a witness and not a teacher. And it is true that this witness enters into an absolute relation with the absolute, but he doesn't witness to it in the sense that to witness means to show, teach, illustrate, manifest to others the truth that one can precisely attest to.
Okay, now I just want you to start again.
Sure.
This time, slowly, so people can hear exclusivity, secrecy, this question of what it is to have faith. And when we talk about Night of Faith, we're going to start talking about art.
Okay.
So just take out the word Night of Faith and put in the word art.
Okay, sure.
Okay, ready? Go again. Simon, you're being saved on this one. This should be Simon's role.
He doesn't speak.
No, start at the ideas.
Okay. The ideas of secrecy and exclusivity are essential here, as is Abraham's silence. He doesn't speak. He doesn't tell his secret to his loved ones. He is, like the art, a witness, and not a teacher. And it is true that this witness enters into an absolute relation, with the absolute. But he doesn't witness to it in the sense that to witness means to show, to teach, illustrate, manifest to others the truth that one can precisely attest to.
So he's basically making a comment like Julie had to deal with. She had to be a witness. That's one way of dealing, you know, when someone tells you a secret, you become the witness to that secret. You're standing by it. He's not witnessing something. He's not teaching. He's not doing this to give an example. He's not doing this to help anybody understand anything. Okay? Try it again at the top. Okay, sure.
The ideas of secrecy and exclusivity are essential here, as is Abraham's silence. He doesn't speak. He doesn't tell his secret to his loved ones. He is, like the art, a witness and not a teacher.
Or just like art.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry. That's what I meant to say. He's a witness, not a teacher. He's not a witness. Go on. Sorry.
That's right.
He is like art.
He is like art, a witness and not a teacher. And it is true that this witness enters into an absolute relation with the absolute. But he doesn't witness to it in the sense that to witness means to show, teach, illustrate, manifest to others the truth that one can precisely attest to. Abraham is a witness of the absolute faith that cannot and must not witness before men.
Okay, what does that sentence
absolute
mean?
Power.
Abraham. Joke again. I'm really sorry, Jenna.
It's okay.
What does this sentence mean?
Sure.
Somebody else.
Abraham is a witness.
Sorry, I'm just having an attack.
God.
Okay.
This is bloody hell.
Well, it's just the sentence that we were read to earlier.
Yes.
To be the relationship between the individual, the absolute relationship between the individual and the absolute. So his secret, his knowledge, or his what he's been witness to is not for anyone else. It's exclusively for him.
Yes.
And it doesn't concern anyone or anything else but for himself and his goal.
Even though it kinda concerns Isaac.
Certainly does, that's true. But in the concept of it doesn't.
But that's what we gotta figure out. Like, it kind of does concern Isaac. So why does Isaac's need sort of get not...
Because he's crazy. Why is he This is my conclusion.
You've grossed
just
three lists of
vocalists
That's right. That's very good. That's what I feel about religion generally. Okay. Trying to set aside the fact whether it was crazy... Let's pretend that it's not crazy. Let's say that there must be some other explanation. What is that other explanation?
Would it help to change the name of Abraham into artist and read it as artist and art?
Let's try that one. Why don't you try that one?
Yes.
Tell me, what name you want to go by?
Dodo.
Not Dodo.
I will not read, I'm sorry. It's
no.
Awful.
No.
Dodo.
Doro. Doro, that's it. Doro. Doro.
Not Dodo.
Not Dodo.
Dodo,
that's so bad. What's happened to this class? My God. Okay, sorry. Doro. Can you read this with the word artist in it?
Really not, because my reading is...
No, you. One line is not going to be bad.
Which one is...
The one that says Abraham.
They will say Abraham.
Here.
No, that one. Artist is a witness of the absolute art that not and must not witness before man.
How do you hear that? Fred, does that make... No, that sounds good. That sounds that's excellent. Fred, what did you make of that? Does that make sense to you now? No.
Does it become that art is something that is transcendent? So it cannot be kind of
head down, so we can only kind of experience it, but it cannot be ever truly understood or kind of shared with others. That I don't know.
Look at that photo there. Let's assume that that is a piece of art.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, it's certainly framed as a piece of art. Is that a witness to the landscape? Would you say that that's a witness? Is that telling a story?
Yes.
Can't stress anything else.
So it communicates, but it doesn't communicate exact experience artists went through to make this.
Yeah. Well, what story is that telling?
The world is upside down.
This last comment was quite to the point.
Can you repeat it?
No?
No, not really. The last thing you said, I think, is quite to the point. Because you made a very subtle difference between... Do you remember what you said?
The picture communicates what artist wanted to show, but it does not show experience artist went through when he was creating it.
It's
something like that.
Or she.
Yeah. Or she, yes. Indeed. Maybe...
Close. Okay, so if we have art is a witness of the absolute relation to art, or the artist is a witness, not a vessel. But that witnessing cannot tell a story, cannot act as the... You know when you call someone up to a court and you say you want to have a witness say something, you're going to have the witness say, this is what happened and happened this way. That's not what art does. Art is not going to say, this is what happened and happened this way. So you're right, but it can tell a story, but the story isn't necessarily a story of the only way to tell the story. It just, like, if we look at this piece here, I don't know how many people can see it, because the question's wet. It's saying something, but what is it saying?
So it's not questioning, right?
It could be questioning, but it's not. It's not there to bear witness. It's there to do something. It witnesses, but it doesn't bear witness in the same. It doesn't. It's not there to express something that is absolutely the case all the time, 100% of the time, or as you were saying, the making of it.
It is also to remain with the examples of this prophet Abraham. If one thinks there's another figure, Moses. Moses at one time is turning to God and receiving the laws, and then turns around and can present those laws to people. So there can be a translation of communication. In the case of Abraham, there isn't. And that's the whole point.
Is this a role of art?
Yes. Not only is it a role of art, but it's the role of the artist who must learn that, or must accept that fact. This is the point here, that you must accept, not in the fact that you're one is this great genius thing or humble creep, that you have to, it just is about the is. You just are. I'm going to go choke again. I'm sorry about that. You want to...
Well, it can be articulated in many ways when you start looking at it as for the artist. But to me, what is very important is to move away from thinking that one enters the artistic process with the intention of saying something, of meaning something, and then works through the process and then ends up with one sort of representation or another of the initial intention. That is what, for Kierkegaard, is the ethic, that which can be communicated, can circulate, and it is the same for everyone, but then it's not art, it's public, it's visual communication,
mm-hmm.
advertising.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, it's arriving at a point where the possibility of communication vanishes in linear terms, and still being there, doing something. And then the artist comes back and is somehow on the same position as the public would be. And they're both looking at this thing there.
So in this sense, the thing that is, but is not meaning X or Y, it just is. And that's precisely when it becomes interesting, when it becomes, you know, everybody's value, and you keep returning to it.
Okay, Jez, what, you're going to be the next one to read. Here, you can use this. Clearly, you can't read
that. I really can't see that.
Okay, yeah. So.
Can't zoom in.
So, if you can start here, but go down to the bottom of this paragraph. So, you start here. Yeah. Just try the words to start. So, we're on page 73.
73?
Of the gift of death.
The last
Abraham is witness of the absolute faith that cannot and must not witness before men.
Okay, so translation.
Art is a witness of the artist.
Okay, good. So the artist does some kind of witnessing, but it's not able to give a definite form of truth. Okay, try that sentence again.
Abraham is a witness of the absolute faith that cannot and must not witness before men.
Yeah.
He must keep his secret. But his silence is not just any silence. Can one witness in silence? By silence? The tragic hero, on the other hand, can speak, share, weep, complain. He doesn't know the dreadful responsibility of loneliness. Agamemnon can weep and wail with Clytemnestra and Iphigenia. Tears and cries are relieving. There is consolation in them. Abraham can neither speak nor commiserate, neither weep nor wail. He is kept in absolute secret. He feels torn. He would like to console the whole world, especially Sarah, Elysia and Isaac. He would like to embrace them before taking the final step. But he knows that they will then say to him, "But why are you doing this? Can't you get an exemption, find another solution, discuss, negotiate with God?" Or else they will accuse him of dissimulation and hypocrisy. So he can't say anything to them. Even if he speaks to them, he can't say anything to them. He speaks no human language. And even if he understood all the languages of the world, he still could not speak. He speaks in a divine language. He speaks in tongues.
Yeah, just keep going.
If he were to speak a common or translatable language, if he were to become intelligible by giving his reasons in a convincing manner, he would be giving in to the temptation of the ethical generality that I have referred to as that which makes one irresponsible. He wouldn't be Abraham anymore. The unique Abraham in a singular relation with the unique God. Incapable of making a gift of death, incapable of sacrificing what he loved, hence incapable of loving and of hating, he wouldn't give anything anymore. Abraham says nothing but his last words, those that respond to Isaac's question have been recorded. God himself will provide the lamb for the Holocaust, my son. If he had said, "There is a lamb, I have one," or "I don't know, I have no idea where to find the lamb," he would have been lying, speaking in order to speak falsehood. By speaking without lying, he responds without responding.
Okay, so we'll just stop there for a second. Now, do you just think this is all just gobbledygook? Or do you think that, how are you hearing this? Because we're talking about a murder, or the possibility of a murder. We're talking about, it is a bit mad to think that someone's telling you, "Go kill yourself." And then, you know, the issues he's having around, well, you know, he says to Sarah, "I'm going to do this." Clearly she's going to have an issue with this. And just, you know, so he's saying that if he's able to say, that puts him in the category of tragic hero. Because then you can cry, you can weep, everybody can, like, figure out how can this be negotiated. If, on the other hand, he doesn't say, but he's doing it for reasons other than the reason that is simply in the relationship to the absolute, then he's a hypocrite. Mm-hmm. Then he's doing this for other reasons other than this absolutely specific relationship of a one-to-one to the absolute. Now think about it. Forget about the fact that he's talking about God for the moment. The notion of the absolute this relationship that is being established with your work, with your artwork, in relationship to, let's call it the bigger picture. Where does it sit? How does it sit? In relation to this bigger picture, if there is no relationship to the bigger picture, it isn't going to work as art. If it is, in fact, only the bigger picture, it's also not going to work as art. Sometimes it works, sometimes this fact is hidden because the work is representational, so it has a more of a cohesiveness, so you can see it immediately. But for those of you that are working in environments that are not representational, like, for example, the upside-down mad picture that you see over there, even though there's figural images of a tree of some kind or roots, for those of you that are working like that, if it cannot somehow maintain the secret, if it cannot call something to itself and at the same time have sort of a sitting of being witnessed, it will not work. So that's step one that's being said. Step two is that if you as the artist don't understand the requirement of solitude, of extreme solitude, then you're also going to have problems as an artist. At some point, this is part of the argument. Now, Andy Warhol might have an issue with this. He might have been really tired of this whole argument of, you know, the artist, you know, like going off in the garret and, you know, trying to think about things. But there's something to be said here. Yeah, I know, I'm sorry. You know what's going on with the joking? Gas. Anyway, sorry. But there's something that one needs to understand how the art operates in this moment of a relationship between an absolute and a path. There's a path, the absolute's the goal, there's this relationship that's going on, and what you need to try and figure out, what you need to try and hear in this, is how that relationship is being established. Questions? Tom, how are you hearing this?
Yeah, it's cool.
That's perfect.
So it is art what binds the absolute to the path of you.
Very astute. Can you say that again?
Art is what binds the absolute to the path, to your path.
Mm-hmm. And that has to be a form of a witness, but it's not a witness that teaches. It's not a witness that tells the truth. Mm-hmm. It's a witness that is the truth. Just screaming from the room. Can you repeat that one more time, Lily?
Art binds the absolute with the path.
Can you give it? Yes.
Abraham is witnessing the absolute on his path, which is only visibly understood by Abraham. And that requires quality.
Did you say quality?
Quality. And he has got only that quality, which he communicates with the absolute on the special language.
No, it doesn't require the quality. It requires something else that starts with a T.
Taylor.
No.
Is it not this consciousness?
No.
Time, isn't it?
Trembling.
That's
annoying. No. Should I go out and
come in again? Yeah. Trembling. Trembling. The shudder of thought. Trembling. You're overthinking it in the sense that of the notion of equality. No, it's the tremble. It's the shudder. It's much more of a physical thing rather than a. Let's see if I can put it slightly differently. How did you know, apart from the fact that it had to be that long,
because I've been writing in my notes, what's the trembling about?
Okay, can you explain that now? What's the it that is it about?
I suppose it's back to the the making the unsayable, I suppose.
Okay.
So the A thought is how the unsayable gets thought or gets said.
Good. Maybe. Except in its saying, it's not necessarily saying it.
It's
a physical
it's
condition.
It's felt. It emerges
when,
some other way.
Well, for
the
example,
act was
let's just one second. Sorry, Doris.
The anxiety changed.
Let's look at the woman with the white dress on in the corner of that thing with a pheasant on top of her. I have no idea what that picture's doing. You know, it just works. And it works, this is Samantha Sweeting's work, she's a very interesting artist. It works in part because it is enabling a form of a witnessing that just says. So it's sort of translating what you're, I mean, I'm trying to give you examples of what, in fact, a lot of the pieces in this room are doing that. Can you repeat what you said again about the trembling gun so that people can hear it?
That it's about, it's going back to the idea of a thought. And
A dash thought
and how we make or say the unsayable without speaking is through the notion of trembling.
Yes. Very good. So we move to one last piece of the puzzle. One last piece of the puzzle. In order for this trembling to take hold, Kierkegaard says that one needs to understand that the first task of art is to learn not how to see, but how to listen. How to listen with your eyes. And the listening he calls attunement. One becomes attuned. One becomes not in tune, but like it's like one can relate to the atmosphere. One tunes in. You've ever heard these expressions, right? One's in tune. One's in step. One's attuned. The first task of art is to become attuned. What else do you want to say?
Well, it opens up a whole new seminar, but it is moving away from the linearity and visual. But I am here, my object is there, and it's all under control. Attunement is all around.
It's
atmospheric. And it's, I always imagine it or perceive it or feel it as something that is not coming at. No, I don't get it through my eyes only, or through my ears only. It is a panic feeling.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, what do you call it, an
atmosphere? Panic, yeah.
Panic. What do you call it, an atmosphere? Something that is entire, just whole, as I am in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I become one with it, because that's the attunement. The resonance, two resonances.
And that could be the language.
And that's what?
That would be the language.
That would be the language,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
But it's a very specific kind of language, the
yeah.
attunement language.
That becomes a language.
It's what?
That becomes a language.
Yes. Not
that's
bad.
What I meant.
Now, I realize that this is still not sitting there yet. So, next week, we're meant to start Freud. But do you mind if we just go over this a little bit one more time? But we can also read this is one of my favorite of all time seminars, just what it is to suck. for example, cigarette.